Eastern Conference future.
Well, this is a team that's very near and dear to Tim Doyle's heart, the Orlando Magic, even money to win the Southeast Division. I mean, who is the competition there? It's basically the Miami Heat. Orlando is the only team with a positive point differential, and that's with Banchero missing six games already. He'll be back in about a month from the torn oblique. He is a legit superstar. He was averaging 29, 9, and 6, shooting 50%. And the Wagner brothers stepping up, especially Franz, without him. I like the addition of KCP defensively. This is the number two defensive team in the league. Anthony Black starting to emerge as a solid point guard. I just think they have better depth than the Heat. Probably will come down to the last 2 weeks like it did last season, but take the Magic, even money, to repeat as division champs.
Tim was smiling and I think admiring your pronunciations there, as was I. Alex, you are on a similar play, if not the same play. I guess I got to play the Magic if you and Larry are on it.
Yeah, I'm aligned with my colleague Larry here. I think it's a great look, the Magic to win the Southeast Division here. This Magic team, I just love the way this roster is constructed. One of the deepest teams in the league. They could potentially play 10 or 11 men. Tremendous depth. If we look at the bench, I love the way they've drafted as well. Brought in a lot of in-house talent. I love the acquisition of KCP to already great defense. The Magic were a very good defensive unit last year. That certainly carried over, as Larry mentioned, top three in defensive efficiency this season. And Paolo Banchero looked like a viable, legitimate MVP candidate before the injury. Franz Wagner looks like an all-star caliber player as well. So this team certainly, I think, is going to flirt with winning potentially 50 games. I love their chances of winning the division. As Larry mentioned, only real competition is Miami. Miami doesn't really care about winning the division. They just want to get into the postseason unscathed if possible. So I think this Orlando team is set up nicely to have a great regular season and cap it off by winning the Southeastern Division in the process.
Tim, by my math, the Cleveland Cavaliers are on pace to go 82-0. You have a play on them. What's the play on the Cavs?
Is that why you went to law school all those years, Sia? Yes. Okay. I'm happy you didn't become an accountant. You would have been an exceptional accountant as well. I gave out everybody Orlando last year. I'm happy that everyone's jumping on the bandwagon now. I told everybody, Paolo and Franz are going to pump you up, my friend. Another good thing going for Orlando, they've played seven games away in only four games at home. They're home tonight. We're going to dive into that Charlotte-Orlando matchup. Magic are seven and a half point favorite over Charlotte. My future with the Cavs is best record at the All-Star break. Now, obviously, I have a jump on everybody because I haven't lost the game. But, yes, they have 2.5 on Boston. But, okay, the Celtics are your main competition. Do you look at the Pacers, Magic, Knicks, or Nets and be like, oh, yeah, they're going to be in first place by the All-Star break? So this is a two-horse race. Now, the difference for me with Cleveland is versus Boston, just to the All-Star break, you're getting plus 135, is regular season matters for the Cavs. You think the regular season matters for the Celtics? It doesn't matter. It's championship or bust. You know, Alex just made the point about the Miami Heat. The way they're constructed, it's not about winning regular season games. That's why I like their division bet. For the Magic, right, it's about winning, like putting up the banner. I don't even know who plays in which division anymore, but it matters to the Heat. It matters to the franchise, selling tickets, the players, the coaches. So for the Cavs, if they can go into the All-Star break with the best record, that means something. Their head coach, Kenny Atkinson, obviously coached in Golden State, and he's brought over that mantra to the Cavs. Everyone understands their role. I actually gave Kenny Atkinson the business a few times in summer leagues. We're from the same neck of the woods on Long Island, right? And when he would guard me, Sia, I would go, mouse in the house, because I got him by about 4 inches. But he's been an amazing coaching addition for the Cavs. I think the regular season matters to Cleveland, and you're getting plus odds. Give me they have the best record at the break.
All right, I love the plus money on that one. Let's move to the Western Conference. Larry, I start with you again. What's your favorite Western Conference future?
I took a shot on the Phoenix Suns plus 800 to win the West with Coach Bud bringing in a totally new style of offense. They're jacking up the threes. They're making the threes. Set a franchise record for the first 10 games, over 150 threes made. Seven guys are making more than four per game. So they were not really taking advantage of their strength last season because they shot at a very high percentage, but they didn't shoot them enough. And so he's come in and they're playing a different brand of basketball. It's not just three offensive guys, although Durant is out now for a couple of weeks. You've also got guys like O'Neal. You've got Grayson Allen. You've got a well-balanced roster with a championship type coach. I don't think it's a mirage what we've seen so far from the Suns.
All right, Proppy, I go to you, but I do need to take note. The Hans and Franz Saturday Night Live reference, some of you at home really appreciated that. I certainly did as well. Proppy, I don't know that you get that reference, but you have a pick in the Western Conference.
I certainly get the reference. See, yes. I'm an old guy, even though I look young. But yeah, I'm going to actually fade the Houston Rockets. We're going to go the Houston Rockets to miss the playoffs at plus 150, guys. Now, look at this Houston team. While I do think they have a lot of young talent, they really lack real experience in the playoffs. Fred VanVleet is the only starter that's played meaningful minutes in the postseason. They're very young. I also look at this Western Conference. They're absolutely stacked. By my count, there's 12 teams that are going to compete to make the playoffs. And that's if we don't include New Orleans. Sorry to mention them, Tim, that, you know, we're a playoff team last year. But yeah, this Western Conference is absolutely loaded. I think it's going to be hard for this Houston team. That's, again, very young. I still think they're a year or two away before they're a legitimate team. I think we saw last season got off to a good start and really kind of struggled down the stretch. I think they're set up to do the same thing this year. If we look at their schedule, it's been pretty soft thus far. Their schedule post All-Star break is significantly more difficult. So love fading this Rockets team, especially at the price point of plus 150 to miss the playoffs.
All right, Tim, your turn. Western Conference future.
You know, we had a good thing going, Alex. You know, we were laughing, we were joking about Saturday Night Live, okay? And then you say the Rockets aren't going to make the playoffs. The Rockets went to Dallas and beat the Mavericks on their home floor. They're 7-4, and they got an important stretch coming up with their schedule. They got the Clippers twice at home. Got to think they're going to be favorite in both those games. And then they go to the Bulls. I think they could be 10-4. I think you're absolutely crazy. I'm also high on the Rockets. Last year, I gave them at 31 over-under wins. Blew through that number. They ended up with 41. Now this year, 43.5. They're going to blow through that number again. I love their bench. They haven't even started yet. Like Reed Shepard's off to a slow start. Torrey Eason, I'm really high on. I was going to say this. If the Rockets make the playoffs, I want to see the hair totally out on Alex. I want to see what the man bun comes out. What, like, how far does it go down? If they don't make the playoffs, I will shave my head. Now, I only have one nightmare at night. That is my hair falling out. So I'm not going to make that bet. That bet is not on the board, okay? It's off the board. As far as my Western Conference future, I got Golden State to win the Pacific. Now, you know, we talked about real contenders in divisions, and that's why I love their breakdown of Orlando, because the rest of their division is terrible after the Heat. You got Atlanta, Washington, Charlotte, really teams that are not competing. I look at the Pacific right now, and I see Phoenix. I agree with Larry. I thought Phoenix had a high ceiling because they got some continuity playing one another after a year. You got Bradley Beal, Booker, and Durant. Ryan Dunn's been a really nice addition for him. But when I look at Golden State, they've actually played 7 games on the road. They're 6-1 and only 3 games at home. And that division overall, I think it's Phoenix or them. The Lakers, Sacramento, Clippers. I don't really consider regular season teams. You know what I like about Golden State? Kyle Anderson, Jonathan Kuminga. They're defending at a high level. Yeah, they got embarrassed by the Cavs on that night, but that was a long road trip that they were on. Came back, bounced back, blowout OKC. I think Golden State's a really like a legit threat to win it all. They just have really good pieces that fit in extremely well. They're deeper than normal. More importantly, Draymond Green staying on the floor. So give me Golden State to win the Pacific.
All right, we move on to a finals winner future. Larry, it looks like you like Boston back-to-back.
Yeah, it's boring, but they bring back the team that dominated, never even got to a game 6 in the playoffs, 164 in the regular season. Obviously, it depends on health, but last year they didn't even have Porzingis for most of the playoffs, and it didn't stop them at all. And the other night when they lost to Golden State, almost came back to beat them. They were missing two of their three best players. So I just think this team remains the cream of the crop. And the East, to me, with Philly and Milwaukee down, Cleveland is up. You know, maybe the Knicks pull it together, but they just have such, I feel, an easy path to the finals. I'll take the Celtics to repeat.
All right, Tim, I'm actually going to go to you next because I think this is a nice transition from Boston to perhaps the aforementioned New York Knicks to win it all.
Yeah, I have preseason tickets with the Knicks, and I agree with Larry. I think Boston at full strength is the class. We saw them on opening night just absolutely whip up on New York, but New York's got an ace in the hole, okay? The Knicks are going to land Giannis. So now when the Knicks get Giannis, okay, now what are they going to give up? Draft? I'm not a GM, okay? That's not my job, okay? My job is to stir the pot. When the Knicks get Giannis, what do their odds go to then? 4-1? 3-1? And by the way, if you've watched Milwaukee Bucks basketball this year, I bless your heart because they've been hard to watch. They are going to blow that thing up. They've been a disaster zone. There's no other way to say it. It's not working. And it's not Giannis's fault. It's actually not Damian Lillard's fault. It's the other three guys that are on the court with them, and then their bench, and then their age, and then Chris Middleton is hurt. So I think Giannis is going to end up somewhere. And if he's looking at a team that's built to win right now with everybody in their prime, I think New York is the place to go, and you're getting 10-1. New York's going to make moves. They have to make moves. They made moves last year. They have to improve their bench. But if they get Giannis, oh boy, this ticket will be alive and kicking.
Breaking news, Giannis to the New York Knicks. Stirring the pot indeed, Tim Doyle. All right, Proppy, you close this out. You're going to the Western Conference for your finals future.
Yeah, and it's fitting that this guy didn't even get mentioned, and I'm talking about the best basketball player in the world, Nikola Jokic. I'm going to go with the Denver Nuggets at 11-1 odds. Nikola Jokic somehow is averaging 30-14-12, and it's the quietest 30-14-12 you've ever seen. Somehow he just continues to get better and better at basketball. For my money, Nikola Jokic is the best offensive player in NBA history. I look at this Nuggets team. I think they've improved from a depth standpoint. Christian Braun has been playing well. Jamal Murray does not look like Jamal Murray yet. I think as the season goes along, we're going to see Jamal Murray looking more like the playoff performer that he has been. Aaron Gordon, obviously out of the lineup right now. When he gets back and healthy, we know how dynamic he is from the dunker spot. Michael Porter Jr. finally starting to get going, shooting 50, 40, 90. So I just look at this Nuggets team. If they can improve the depth a little bit more at the trade deadline, add another veteran piece potentially to come off the bench, I think they're as good as any team in the league, headlined by the best player in the world, who I would never count out. I love the value at 11-1 odds on the Nuggets.
Rookie of the year, really quickly, Prop Stars, who do you think?
This is a wide open race, Katie, but I'm going to go with my favorite rookie, Stephon Castle of the San Antonio Spurs. He just looks so polished to me. He looks better and better every game. You can get him at 16-1 odds, which is a great price point as well. Just looks more and more comfortable. He's a future point guard of this Spurs team. I think him and Victor Wembanyama are going to play over a decade together. I just see his minutes increasing as the season progresses. Obviously, Chris Paul, not known for being super durable. So if there's an injury in that backcourt, I could see him playing 30, 35 minutes. Considering this race is wide open, I love the value we're getting on Stephon Castle.
All right, what do you think of this one, Zach Attack? Who do you like for Rookie of the Year?
I'm going to go with Jared McCain, and we're seeing a big shift with him. Yesterday was plus 450 after his breakout game. He is now on the leaderboard, plus 225. You have a consistency with this 76ers team that's not going to go away. Paul George and Joel Embiid are going to continue to miss time at stretches this season. You also have Tyrese Maxey out, so it's giving McCain a chance to be a standout performer, and he's delivered four straight games of 18 points or more, 34 points last night, and even when they do get healthy, he's going to earn an increase of minutes. He's a pure score. He's going to continue to score and light it up. I'll go with McCain, plus 225.
Yeah, I'm going to look at Zach Edey here. I believe he's at plus 450, plus 325 here. They just don't build guys like this. He's 7'4". He's 305 pounds. He's leading all rookies in rebounds per game. He ranks fourth in scoring defensively. He's just been a monster the way he can swat things down. I've been impressed with him since college. So I will go Zach Edey here at plus 325.